Welcome back to the video of presentation for recurrent neural network. This is Pejman Rusty, and we will go together today to see how we can implement a model for RNN, or especially for LSTM. In the last video, together we saw a simple example how we can use recurrent neural network and in which situation we can implement this type of networks. Let's go and have a look more details in the model. As a first view, the recurrent neural network or RNN looks like this. So we have the input and we have the output that came from the previous state, and it was concatenated to the input. If you remember, it was get back to the example that we had. So the green part was the output of the food that we had yesterday, and the blue part it can be considered as the weather condition. So we were integrating or concatenating these two inputs together, and we will fit them. We fit them to the model. Okay. So here is the step that we have. So concatenation. Then we will fit it to nonlinear model that we saw together. Here we can use tangent hyperbolic. So it can be any other activation function, and then we will go and have the output. The output can be considered as the real output, okay? So we will go and we will stop it, or it can goes to the next node and continue the chain of networks, okay? So we call it H as a internal state that will concatenate with the input of the next step. So here is the mathematical representation of that. So we have the X, it can be considered as the input to our node, that will be the concatenation of the new input with the output of the previous node. So then we will have an activation function, and with the activation function, as I said, we use the tangent hyperbolic. So we have the input, this or X that we had from here. So if you multiply by the weight, and will be added to some bias that we train during the training of the neural network. And then when we go for the output and we wanted to make the decision, so we can use softmax as an output. Okay, that will be the multiplication of the HT that we had as the output of the activation function. It will multiply by some weight and will be added with the bias that we have. So this is how we can mathematically represent recurrent neural network or RNN. So we can go in deep RNN or deep recurrent neural network. So what we were talking, it was just talking about such a this chain of cells, or we call it as well nodes. Here, so we had the chain of this, okay. So if you wanted to go more in deep, we can add a layer next to that, and if you wanted to go more and more, so we can add n layer of such a this chain that we have as the first layer, and then we will get the output at the end of that. So the structure of these two layers are almost the same. There is no difference. The only difference is that the input that will come to this, it will be considered as the output of the previous cell that we had at the first layer. Let's see an example. As you remember, I said that this type of networks can be used when we have a sequence of the data. A text can be an example of that. Okay, a video can be another example of that when we have the sequence of frames. So now we will see together on this when we use the recurrent neural network. So we have a text like this. Michel C was born in Paris, France. So blah 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 blah, and say in after some lines, okay, we say that his mother tongue is, and this is the machine that should predict the mother tongue. Okay, so what the machine should do, it should keep the memory of what we are talking here, and based on the sentence that we had at the beginning of the paragraph, it should make a decision that the mother tongue of Michel is French or any other language, English, German, Russian. But as he born in she born in Paris, as Michel born in Paris, so we can say that it's French. Okay, but there we will have a problem here when we use a recurrent neural network, as we have a long sequence of the data between these two sentences. At some points, a machine or the system will not be capable of doing the good prediction here, because the distance between the initial information and the required information here are long. So in recurrent neural network or mathematics in general optimization, we call it, we have the vanishing of the gradient. Okay, so in that in that case that we have the long context, context, we will have a problem of the prediction. Or if we have a really long video, so we will have a problem as well there. So to solve such a this problem, okay, we can propose another version of the recurrent neural network. So we have the same structure, okay, as the recurrent neural network here in LSTM, long short-term memory, but there is a difference between these two, and the difference is come to inside the node. Here in the recurrent neural network, in the original version of the recurrent neural network, we have just one function. Let's call it tangent hyperbolic, that we use tangent hyperbolic, and we will make a decision based on that. But in LSTM, what we do, we will add other gates to the node, to each node that we have, then it will help us to make some decision. But in which way, we will see together. Here in a node, if I wanted to explain it, so we have some yellow rectangles, okay, that can be considered as the neural network layers that we have in a cell. So we have some pink circles that can be used for pointwise operations. Okay, we have vector transfer. So the vector transfer are such a this vector that will transfer the data from one node to another node. We have such a this two nodes joining to two arrays joining to each other as a concatenation when we have the output of the previous cell with the new input. So we have the concatenation here, and for the last one we have the copy of them. For example, when we have this line, so that we have a copy of this here, a copy of this here, copy of this here, and a copy of the concatenation here, or here that has an output. Okay, we have one copy that will go to the next cell, another copy that can be considered as an output of this node. So let's go and see what are the duty of each nodes or layers inside a node in the LSTM. Okay, in LSTM we have we call it backbone, or we can call it cell state. Cell state is more frequently for this. So this is the state of our network. Okay, so when it goes from one nodes to another nodes, we will add something to that, or we will multiply something to that to update it. Okay, then we update the cell state, and the cell state will go to the next block. Okay, so as I said, we will add some operation to that, so multiplication or adding something to this. So this is what we call it, different gates. So we have different gates that will do the work for us. For example, here so we will use we will have the input, okay, and if you wanted to add it to the cell state, so we have a gate here that this gate will say how much of the information should pass and how much information should be remain as an input, so not going to the cell state. So in that case, we say that a value of 0 means let nothing true, while a value of 1 means let everything true. So this is the function. So this, it gives us a value between 0 and 1. The 1, we pass all the information, we said that this is the necessary information. Or if it returns 0, we say that okay, let nothing throw this. And if it's between, so it will make a decision in how much information it should pass. Okay, so let's go and see step by step the gates that we have in LSTM. So these are the parameters or hyperparameters that we should tune or we should train during the training. This is the reason that we explained them. At the end, when you are implementing it, for example, with the cross, so this is for the whole node or for the whole chain of a recurrent neural network. It's just one line, okay? But we will see what are inside that or what we have as a back end of this. So the first step, when we get the input and we concatenate it with the output of the previous cell, okay, we have the forget gate. So this is a sigmoid function that we use. So we have some weights that we will multiply by, or call it it can be considered as a convolution, okay, by the concatenation of the input with the output of the previous cell. Then we will add a bias to that. Okay, so we call it forget gate. Okay, what it means is that we have the cell state. Okay, it comes from the previous one. The first gate, that is the forget gate, it will make the decision. Okay, how much information from the input should be added to the cell state. Okay, so as we said, if it will be 1, okay, it represents completely keep this, okay, so it keep all the information that we have in that. When it represents 0, it said completely get rid of this, okay, it doesn't pass anything to the cell state. So this is the duty of that. So in our example, we have some information that are not necessary really for our decision that we wanted to have at the end. So the forget gate will remove them and will not let it to pass through the cell state. Then when we have it, so it goes to the second gate that we call it update gate. Okay, so in that we have to update the old cell state. So the old cell state is a CT minus 1. So this is the state that it's come from the previous node in our DAT. And by updating it, we will convert it to CT. That is the state of the current node. Okay. So it is the duty of the update gate. Okay, so update gate, it get a copy of the concatenation of the input. We'll apply the tangent hyperbolic and it will add it to the old version of the cell gate when we had something to be forgotten or to be passed by the new input by the forget gate. Okay, it will update it. Okay, and we'll go further. So in mathematically, okay, we can represent that the current state of this node can be considered as the convolution of the first gate by the old cell state, that can be CT minus 1 plus, okay, that we have it here, to the update version of that. That's what we have as an update. Then we have the CT that can be the output, the cell state of this node. Okay, and then we will go further. And by the input that we had in concatenation of that, we will go to the next step we call it result gate. So in that, it's responsible about what we wanted to have for making the decision. So it comes from the input, it get some information from the cell state, okay, and then multiply these two together, and we will have the new output that can go as the HD, or it can be go it can go out to the second node of our chain. So in that case, so we have three gates, okay, forget gate, update gate, and result gate. We have an input, we have the new cell state, okay, and we have the new output. Okay, or H, that H is the one that we will send to the second node. If you wanted to make a decision, so we will have the output as well. So we have the concatenation, the input with the information from the previous or the last node. Then it goes, the X goes to the forget gate. So we have F. Same X goes to the update gate. Okay, we have some information here as well. Then the same X will go to the result gate. As we know, we have X, F, U, and R. Okay, and now we will go further, and we will have X prime that can represent as the output of the RNN. So when we use the tangent hyperbolic that we have here. Okay, the same input will go to the it will multiply by the some weight and bias. Okay, and we have X prime. And then for the new cell state that comes represent as a city, we have the forget convolution by the old state as old cell state. It will be, we will add it to the update gate, and we will multiply it by the new input. Okay, that we can consider as a new node or cell state. Then for the new output or H, okay, we have the result. Okay, result gate multiply by the tangent hyperbolic of the city that we have here. So what are the modification, but which information it should keep in future information it forgot. Okay, cell state in another word, and we will have the new output. So this can go to the next node, okay, or can be considered as the output. Just for remembering the example that we have, the tangent hyperbolic that we use here is the same as a non-linear function that we use to get the maximum value as a 1, the rest equal to 0. This is from the example that we had from the last video. Then if you wanted to make a decision at this point and we don't want to go for the next point, we can have we can use a softmax, so yt, that can be multiplication of the convolution of the weights that we have by the new H that we found from the cell, plus a bias that can be considered as an output. So this is the whole story about LSTM. Of course, there are other version of the RNN like GRU, zero. And we can use it, so we have the same structure almost with the LSTM, but some gates are different, okay, but the concept is the same. Okay, so that's clear, and by this information we can go for implementation. As I said, whole this process can be done in one line of code in Keras or TensorFlow or PyTorch and so on. So it's not complicated for implementation, but we will see how we can use it in an action. So just as a resource for this topic, recurrent neural network, so there are some courses Stanford for convolutional neural network, for visual recognition, natural language processing with deep learning, and also there are some course of deep learning for in Coursera for this, if you wanted to get know more in details about that. Okay, now that we have this information, in the next video we will see together how we can use this type of network in practice. And we will see the result of that as well. Thanks for your attention, and see you in the next video.